أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما اللهم آمين أما بعد. Tonight's topic is about the fifth hadith in the hadith النووية عن أم المؤمنين عائشة رضي الله وأرضاها أم عبد الله قالت قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فهو رد. The hadith reference stated where the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم has been reported to have said, whoever invents in our matter that which is not part of it, then it is rejected. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he was talking about the matter of the deen. And to understand that, inshallah, we'll mention some definitions that the scholars have, you know, narrated, explaining this hadith. And we'll begin by, you know, highlighting the objective of the creation of the human being. And this way we begin to understand where a bid'ah is acceptable and where a bid'ah is unacceptable. First, as we know, of course, the objective of the creation of the human being is to, first and foremost, worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and second is to establish khilafah on earth, to be a trustee on the face of the earth. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks fi amrina, in our matter, he's speaking in the first one, which serves the first objective, which is the legislation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with, in matters of ibadat. So fi amrina hada means in our deen, in our way of worshipping, be it believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a matter of creed, be it in terms of performing the deeds, be it the words that we utter, tasbih, tahmid, tahleel, istighfar, or be it the actions that we perform in terms of salah and siyam and hajj and everything that follows. So here the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is specifically referring to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, أَمْ لَهُمْ شُرَكَاءُ شَرَعُوا لَهُمْ مِنَ الدِّينِ مَا لَمْ يَأْذَنْ بِهِ اللَّهِ. Perhaps do they have partners that they have legislated as a way of life, as a deen for them, a religion for them, to practice that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not permit. So the creator of all and the sustainer of all is the sole legislator. No one else can take part in the legislation, including the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When we say he legislates on behalf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he says in the Quran, وَمَا يَنطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam does not legislate by way of his own whims and desires, عِيَادًا بِاللَّهِ. However, he legislates by way of the wahi, as he is directed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the archangel Gabriel. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam legislates, he's fulfilling the mission that he was sent with as a messenger, as a Nabi, who is given the news on behalf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. Today I perfected your deen for you, and I have completed my bounty over you, and I've accepted Islam as a way of life, as a way of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, be it the creed, be it the Islam as the pillars of faith, or be it the ihsan. All of that, we take it from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as we are clearly instructed in the Quran, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. Whatever the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has taught you in terms of aqidah and how to perform your ibadah, then that's what you would take. But of course, it pertains to other ahkam, legislations when it comes to dealing with one another, doing business, interacting with one another, that is governed by the Islamic Sharia. وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. Whatever the Prophet ﷺ has forbidden you from attaining, then he must cease from attaining or performing or engaging that act altogether. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, and the ayat are many in the Quran, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. Say, if you truly love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way to achieve the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to follow his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the outcome would be, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love you, وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. And in addition to that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will expiate your sins, and indeed he is the all forgiven, the all merciful. Now, talking about the definition of a bid'ah according to some of the scholars. One scholar defines it by طريقة مخترعة مداومة السلوك عليها يراد بها ابتغاء وجه الله or the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's a tariqa, meaning that it's a way. So it is not a mere mistake that one makes in their salah or in their siyam or in their hajj. If someone does something khilaf sunnah that is different from the sunnah, once or twice we do not say that this person has invented a bid'ah in the deen. So we can't say that. Bid'ah are strictly related to the religion. So if someone errs, we cannot say he's mubtada', he's an inventor, right? Because it's a tariqah, means it's a way that they have adopted. Mukhtara'a means that it's invented. It is not part of the deen. It's not part of the deen the Prophet ﷺ was sent with. And this person has used it as a way of coming close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking his reward and fearing his punishment. So therefore, it's a matter of deen. It's a matter of ibadah. And we know the default in ibadat that it is tawqifiyya. Tawqifiyya means you stop before you perform the ibadah to authenticate that this is a ibadah that the Prophet ﷺ has orders to do. If it's not, if you have doubts, then you cannot proceed until you authenticate your ibadah. In the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, خُذُوا مَنَاسِكَكُمْ عَنِّي, take your acts of worship from me. So for example, if someone, we know that the places of raising the hands as we pray, number one is takbirat al-ihram. Second, when we go into ruku'. Third, when we raise ourselves from ruku'. And fourth is from the first tashahud. From the first tashahud. These are the only places we raise our hands when we pray. So if someone gotten into the habit of raising their hands every time they get up from sujood, as a way of mistake, they're making a mistake, then we bring it to their attention. We say in the authentic hadith, the Prophet ﷺ did not raise his hands from, you know, the sujood. And the scholars collectively agree that there's not a place where you raise your hands when you get up from your sujood. And this person insists upon raising their hands, you know, as they come or as they rise out of sujood, then this person now is practicing a bid'ah. Why? Because it became a habit. And of course he is now emulating, you know, in this habit, he's basically inventing, and then emulating means that he's making it a way of others to follow as a way of worship which the Prophet ﷺ did not teach us. So now the consistent act, using it as a ibadah in their salah, makes it a bid'ah. On the other hand, sometimes the scholars use the word, they use the word bid'ah linguistically speaking, meaning that it's not truly a bid'ah. But in terms of linguistically speaking, we'll give a couple of examples. At the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, we know that the Prophet ﷺ, before he passed away, he used to pray Taraweeh. But he did not pray it consistently. And we know that the Sahaba used to pray behind him. And when he saw that so many of them gathered to pray Taraweeh behind him, he stopped praying. So the scholars commenting on this, they say he stopped praying fearing that it becomes obligatory. He's the legislator on behalf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by way of the wahi. And then he stopped fearing that it becomes obligatory. But when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, that reservation, that fear is no longer there. Because the deen has been perfected. And so therefore nobody can add, delete, revise or do any of that. So at the time of Umar radiallahu anhu arda, people used to pray Taraweeh individually. They would come to the masjid and each one would individually pray the Taraweeh. So he gathered all of them to pray behind one imam. He gathered all of them to pray. So when he was asked about that, he said, نِعْمَ الْبِدْعَةِ تِلْكِ. Indeed, this is a good bid'ah. We need to understand what's a good bid'ah and what's a bad bid'ah. All bid'ah are bad. But in this sense, Umar radiallahu anhu is saying that this is, linguistically speaking, it's a bid'ah in the sense that it's a sunnah that has disappeared. Meaning that he's reviving this sunnah and he's gathering people around one imam, just like they used to gather at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. Similarly, we see at the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu, people have forgotten, you know, the sunnah of al-duha, you know, after we pray Fajr, and maybe 15-20 minutes later, afterwards we pray, you know, it's called sunnat al-awwabin, or salat al-awwabin, the prayer of those who often return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you can pray 2, 4, 6, or 8. So at the time the Prophet ﷺ, the Sahaba were in power, they were poor. They didn't have the means. So a lot of their time was spent basically studying the deen, spreading the deen, and trying to earn a living. And they were, you know, so destitute, they were so poor, that they did not pray Sunnah al-Duha. At the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu, you know, things were, Baytul Mal was filled. with wealth, and people have had an easier time to live, and the means of living have increased, you know, the sustenance has increased. So Abdullah ibn Umar, who's the son of Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he revived this sunnah al-duha. So in this case, this is also a bid'ah in the sense that linguistically speaking, it's a sunnah that people have forgotten about. It's a sunnah that people have forgotten about. So it existed at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. It is part of our deen. It is not something new. He's simply reviving the sunnah. So referring to this one as a bid'ah, only linguistically speaking, it's a bid'ah. It is not an invention in the deen. Now we come to other bid'ah, which bid'ah that are pertinent to our second mission in life, which is establishing khilafah. For example, part of establishing khilafah is that we invented a new means of transportation. You know, cars, buses, trains, airplanes. We paved the roads. None of that was present at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. These types of bid'ah are not what's intended by the hadith. These types of bid'ah, at minimum, they are permissible. Why? Because they facilitate our lives. And they could rise from permissible to liked, means that mandub. Why? Because there's so much benefit in it that it facilitates people's life, you know, to go around and to go about doing their business and coming to the masajid and so on and so forth, and visiting each other and traveling. So that could be rise to the level of mandub. It could also rise to the level of obligatory. For example, it's incumbent upon the ummah collectively to be self-sufficient when it comes to feeding itself, producing goods, providing services, all of that. And if the ummah collectively does not become independent, then the ummah at large is sinful. So there has to be educated people, specialized experts in every area to make sure that this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam can be self-sufficient and not dependent on others. As we see ourselves now, we are very weak because we are dependent on other nations every step of the way. We have so much expertise that goes around, but yet we do not take the time to benefit ourselves with it. Oftentimes we provide this service and we export this expertise to those who use it, you know, very well in their homelands, and unfortunately oftentimes they use it against us too. Okay? So in this case, this hadith is not talking about, you know, a bid'ah that is pertinent to this life as we live it. So if someone decides to wear, you know, pants and garment, we cannot come and say this person is mubtada. If someone decides to eat, you know, with a fork and knife and a spoon, we cannot say this person is a mubtada because the hadith does not apply to the ways of life we live ourselves. But if someone intentionally wears the garments of a rabbi, these are the clothes specific known to serve a particular religious purpose for rabbis, or a particular religious purpose for, you know, a priest or a minister or any of that, and this person intends to wear these garments and come with them to the masjid, then this person is a mubtadi'. Why? Because these garments are prohibited. These garments are prohibited for us to wear because they symbolize another millah, another religion, another creed, another faith. Okay? So now we come to the issue of which one is worse, a bid'ah or a sin. Really, there's no straight one answer to this, you know, to this question. It depends on the level of the bid'ah, and it depends on the level of the sin. Some bid'ah could rise up to the level of shirk, wal'iyadu billah. Meaning that if someone changes the creed that the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us, how to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his prophets and messengers and angels on the day of judgment and predestination, preordination, and they insist upon that, then they say they have committed shirk. And of course, as you know, shirk is two types. One thing that can cause one to exit the state of Islam, and one, it's a shirky deed, but it does not cause one to exit the state of Islam. So if it rises up to the level of shirk, definitely it's better than, a sin. On the other hand, if a sin rises to the level of disbelief, causes one to exit the state of Islam, to become an apostate after being a believer, or to commit shirk, which is shirk al-akbar, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala obliged himself not to forgive, if one dies in that state of shirk and the bid'ah is smaller, then of course, you know, that deed is worse than the bid'ah itself. If the two are equal in their intensity, the bid'ah is worse. Why the bid'ah is worse? Because the sin, you are only harming yourself. And if you die on that sin, your sin dies with you. Meaning that your tab does not keep on adding up more sins that you practice in this dunya, because your time is up. However, if you taught this bid'ah to somebody else and they continue to practice it after you pass away, you continue to inherit, part of the sins or share of the sins that they have committed. Why? Because you are the original inventor of this sin. For example, Habil and Qabil, when Qabil, pledged to kill his brother, there was no such a thing as murder on earth. It was an invented sin that Qabil, has basically invented it to kill his brother to revenge from him, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would accept from Habil and he would not accept from Qabil. So in this case, in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that it's never the case that a soul, is killed on the face of the earth except that Qabil gets a share of this sin. Why? Because he's the one who invented this bid'ah. He's the one who invented this sin. So therefore, he continues to reap a share with every murder that takes place on the face of the earth until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, destroys this world as we know it. So going back to the hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Man ahdatha fi amrina hadha ma laysa min fahu rad." Whoever invents in our deen that which is not part of it, then it's rejected. It is turned against this person. It is not accepted from this person. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, almost every time he given a khutbah on the member, he warned from al-bid'ah. And he would say, "Inna sharra al-umuri muhdathatuha wa kullu muhdathatin bid'ah wa kullu bid'atin dalalah wa kullu dalalatin fid-dar." Meaning that the worst of matters and inventions in the deen, and every invention is an act of innovation and alteration of the authentic and divine religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is a bid'ah, an invention that is ultimately being a misguided, an act of misguidance that doomed to the hellfire, iyadu billah. Similarly, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned as he sat in the company of a group of his companions, and he has given them advice, and then one of them asks, is there, "O Prophet of Allah, it sounds like an advice of one who is going to part ways with us." Muwaddi' means someone who is going to part ways with us. He said, "Whoever among you will live a long time or will come thereafter, they will see so much change in the deen, just like we see today. We see so many different deviant sects who claim to be Muslims, whose creed is completely corrupt, who are attacking the Sahaba, and who are claiming that the Sahaba are among those the most corrupt, in spite of the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that these are the finest of people to walk the face of the earth after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in them there is a sunnah for us to follow." And similarly in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam echoes that statement by saying, "Idha dhukira sahabati fa'amsiku." When my companions are mentioned in a gathering, hold back from criticism, hold back from saying anything negative. And similarly, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Alaykum bi sunnati wa sunnati al-khulafa ar-rashidin al-mahdiyin." Follow my sunnah and the sunnah of al-khulafa ar-rashidin al-mahdiyin. Those who are guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon knowledge. So if someone is to call these khulafa of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam corrupt or apostates or disbelievers or any of that, what have they done? They have gone against the testimony of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is divine. He does not give testimony by way of his own opinion. He does not legislate by way of his own whims and desires. It's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran and in the Sunnah. So this person is saying something different or contrary to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself said, to what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself said. So who is the corrupt here? Indeed, the one who is making the claim. عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ. So in this gathering where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given advice, knowing that he is shortly will part ways with the Sahaba, he said, "Whoever among you lives a long time or comes, a long time after me, will see so much change in the deen." He said, "Follow my sunnah and the sunnah of al-khulafa al-rashidin al-mahdiyin. Uddu alayha bin nawajib." It's an expression to say that hold on tightly to it. Don't let it, out of your hands. Follow the sunnah. And the only way for us to follow the sunnah is first and foremost to learn the sunnah. Because you find many people out there who claim to, follow the sunnah. And if they see that you're practicing Islam in ways different from their understanding, they'll come and say, "Oh, you're not following the sunnah." But the fact of the matter, if someone is to criticize your act of worship, and they say that you're making a mistake in your salah, in your siyam, in your hajj, and any of that, and you know that the information you have is authentic, and they're saying this is haram, or this is forbidden, or this is that, then they say, bring the evidence. And as we know, the evidence is four different levels. Evidence from the Qur'an, evidence from the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, evidence by way of ijma'. Ijma' means the collective opinion of the scholars, that this is the right interpretation of this ayah. This is the right interpretation of this hadith, okay? And then qiyas. Qiyas, we mentioned this before, is basically matters that the Qur'an and the Sunnah did not specifically speak about. For example, nowhere in the Qur'an and the Sunnah says that narcotics are prohibited. But we look, we see that alcohol is prohibited. And what is the reason for the prohibition of alcohol? Because it compromises the judgment of the human being, it causes intoxication, and it causes a person to behave, in many respects, foolishly. So therefore, drugs do the same and worse. So the scholar said, measurably, this is prohibited. The scholar said, cigarettes are prohibited because they cause, you know, so much harm to the body, you know, cancer, lungs, mouth, and other issues. So measurably, every type of tobacco is going to cause the same problem. So therefore, measurably, that's the fourth level of evidence. You know, all types of tobacco are prohibited because they cause the same problem. So these are the four different levels of evidence. And anyone who is about to perform ibadah, or is performing ibadah and somebody else is claiming that it's wrong, then it's incumbent upon those who are making such claim to bring the evidence and say, this is the right way and this is the wrong way. This is the only way that we can worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by learning the Qur'an, by learning the Sunnah, and applying it as closely as we can. هذا والله تعالى أعلى وأعلم سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خيرا السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.